Okay, so thank you very much for coming. I work with the park board, and we're really lucky to work here in Vancouver on the unceded traditional territory at the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh. This place that's also called Vancouver, and we're grateful for that. I just wanted to also say, if you're in Vancouver, I also have the great good fortune to work with a group of community arts programmers. And they're integral in our city for the programs, projects, and moving forward this field of work. You've met Cindy and Marie now. I just wanted to do a quick little shout out, which I don't know what a shout out means, I realized, to the other arts programmers who, if they're sitting here and not cleaning up in the kitchen or doing something, if you could wave. So Danita Noyes, she may well be cleaning up in the kitchen. Lori Wager. Yeah, you're probably going to. I'm just going to say the names. Margaret Naylor, who happens to be here. Caroline Lifman, who you've met. Rebecca Till, Brenda Racanelli, Rena Sutar, and Hilary Davis. And of course, we've got our newest recruit, an assistant programmer, Clara Chan, who's also here today. So if you see any of those names, feel free to grab them and, you know, grill them. So, yeah, I'm a great colleague. But we have gathered here now to look at, you know, how can we do this work? What can make it possible? When we were talking together the other day, we talked about some kind of key areas to think about. What kind of partnerships are there that could really help with this work? What exchanges or in-kind relationships, you know, space, administration, even printing, what can that do to assist? Training, you know, you're a dancer, you're interested, you're a choreographer, you're interested in moving this work forward, you're a community programmer, where can you get some training? Participants, how do you connect with community members? And how do you find an artist if you are in a community? So how do you find those people that need to be brought together? And of course, the big F word, as Marie said earlier, fundraising. Though we do want to keep that piece of the conversation on the big picture stuff, there will be opportunities after the panel and tomorrow to pigeonhole people who are funders to talk about your particular project or your proposal. So just being cognizant that we're all here, so we'll keep it a bit more in the broader stuff. Our presenters have been kind enough to join us, knowing that we're only going to give them 8 minutes. We're going to flash lights in their eyes, and we're going to get music to come on at the 8 minute point, and it will grow to a crescendo if the desire to speak continues at the same time. And that's just because we know that there's a lot of questions, interest, knowledge in the group that's gathered here, and we really want to make that, you know, turn into a real conversation. So, and I'll have just a couple of notes I've got from the check-in on the wall that I'll help to prime the pump. Anyway. Our presenters, we've got five presenters here today, and our first one is Johal. And these are not going to be real. These are the mythologies that are attached to the people. Just briefly, Am is the magic man of SFU. He's the Escher of academe and community engagement. Am.
Thank you for that wonderful introduction. Great to be here with you this afternoon. I'm gonna touch base first just around my own kind of experience with dance. I was a long time in a previous life a PE student at UBC, and one of the options to take a class was in dance. And I grew up in small town BC in Williams Lake, and there were very few art galleries, very few shows going on. And one of the things that we were able to do, besides choreograph our dance performance for the final the final project was that we got free tickets to go to the Kulch and to have your mind blown away by the work going on in the city. And I went on and worked predominantly in community organizing and politics, but the arts was always a part of my life in terms of being an escape from the intensity of that world. And to be at SFU the past 5.5 years has been an amazing way to combine the kind of the political, social, artistic, and cultural that is an interplay, because we are part of the downtown East Side neighborhood, and there's huge issues around gentrification, overdose deaths, many, many social issues. And so the arts is very much infused with those questions as well. And taking a school for contemporary arts that was up on Burnaby Mountain and now is embedded in the city, there's a whole bunch of bureaucratic challenges as well, and ethos of a school of how to fit in and function and be part of both the cultural community and the downtown East Side community as well. I'm just going to start with the PowerPoint right now. I hope it's going to come up here shortly. Yeah. There's a foundation term that's called creative placemaking, but once I began my position, I prefer to use the word place breaking, because I think it gets better at the antagonisms inherent in the types of roles that many of us play inside of institutions, because the existing policies, whether it's a university, a community center, or some other context, they work against the very kind of principles around community engagement that they want to foster. So everything from booking policies to accessibility. The first thing when you walk into SFU, you see a security desk before anything. The entire first year that SFU was there, the front door, which is its official address, was closed to the public. So trying to navigate all of these things to do what you're actually attempting to do. I'm just going to give a little bit of an overview, and I look forward to the conversation afterwards of the types of partnerships we're working on. This Super Cool Tuesdays is an artist talk series that we're running out of the Interurban Gallery. It was a couple of blocks east of SFU, and much more accessible for residents of the neighborhood. Andrea Creamer, who's there in the on the right-hand side, is actually a former Langara recreation student who worked with me for 4 or 5 years and is now at U of T doing her master's. We work with existing organizations in the neighborhood that already had relationships built up rather than invent new ones. Project Limelight is a performing arts nonprofit that predominantly works with Strathcona Elementary School and others. And we make space available, like the Faye and Milton Wong Theater. We have 400 parents from East Vancouver that come and attend. We support tech costs. But for each partnership, it's very different because of their needs and also the limitations of budgets and access to space, because we're still primarily a school for contemporary arts. In the downtown East Side, 10% of the population is Indigenous, and so there's a real important piece to increase the amount of Indigenous programming that's happening along with community partners. There's a long social justice tradition in the downtown East Side, so we infuse that through the public programming that we do. We do about 100 public events a year. We're a university, so we're in the process of the dissemination of ideas. And so discussions around art and culture, the city, social justice, environmental justice are very much built into what we're trying to do. We've used this notion of the right to culture, which is there's already a strong culture in the neighborhoods that we work in, but if we're going to infuse it across the DNA of our own organization, it means that when Robert Lepage comes in with a $60 or $70 ticket, we build into contracts with our partners the amount of community tickets that we have, or we'll do a ticket buy that can then be distributed through our community partnerships, so we can just build it into how we work across the different ways. This is Vanessa Richards. Many of you know we support the Woodward's Community Choir that she runs in the social housing part of Woodward's, being part of that complex. Karen James, and I know there's a number of you here that do work with Karen, so she's been a partner of ours for the past 5 years. They do work out of the World Arts Center, and there's usually an annual performance at the heart of the City Festival, which we also are a part of each year. We're partnered with Megaphone Magazine, which we run a community journalism class out of our boardroom. This is usually done for corporate bookings, but we bring in coffee and food, and these are neighborhood residents who are writing stories from a community perspective that are published in the magazine that many of you buy on the street. Of course, this is the number slide. You know, you work in institutions, so you have to show unlimited growth and all of these things going on. But I think one of the challenges that I think cuts across other institutions as well is that the different types of partnerships that we do, because there's such a crisis of space in the city, you quickly hit capacity and then a limitation of how it is that you can accommodate new partnerships. I think this is a really a good question to be discussing. These are just some other programming that we do. I think I'll leave it here for now, and I look forward to the discussion.
Thank you very much. Magic Man, what did I say? Okay, we're lucky now. Our second presenter is Judith Marcuse, who I think a lot of us know and have respected for many years. Dancer, choreographer, researcher, teacher, and world change maker. Judith.
Hi, everybody. Can you do me a favor? Could you put up your hands to self-identify if I sort of say a category? So hands up. Who in the room is an artist? Okay. And put your arms up as many times as you like. Who is working as an artist in dance in community settings? Okay. How many people had training to do this? How many people are running programs that include dance? Okay. How many of you are subsidized by government programs? Okay. How many of you are educators working in educational settings? And how many of you work in intercultural or intergenerational contexts? Great. Just two more questions. How many people are doing most of their work as volunteers? Okay. Are there people working in health here? I know it's more than one question. In the health sector? Okay. Couple. Okay. Thank you very much. It just helps me to think about how I can be of most service to us all. So, first of all, a few definitions. In community engaged arts, we have many, many definitions, each with its own nuances and goals. So there's art for social change, there's community engaged art, there's animation culturelle, there's community art, there's social practice art, there's arts access, there's all kinds of names in each of these categories, and of course, recreational arts. And each one of these has different goals, different methodologies, but there are some underpinning principles to the work pretty much across the board. Just to be aware of the fact that the field is expanding exponentially right now, and people are sort of using different languages to describe sometimes the same thing, but sometimes they use the same words to describe other things. So it's a bit of a confusing time for us trying to get our handle on what's actually going on and what to call it. What's the language that defines the particular kinds of work that we do? That's just a preamble. So I've been asked to talk about partnerships because I've just finished, just completed 50 one-hour interviews with people across the country about the subject of partnerships. And the more I heard from colleagues across the country working, particularly in art for social change, that's the practice where artists act as facilitators or nurturers for groups of people to make art themselves about what matters to them. That's how we define it. I hear more and more of the critical and core essential quality of developing partnerships. And not just partnerships that are one-off for a single project, but it's really about developing relationships with people within your own community and outside of it who understand what you're doing, but also have a vested interest in their own profit from the work that you do together. So in an ideal partnership, everybody gains. Everyone who's in the room in a partnership gains equally in some measure. And these are the kinds of partnerships that take a long time to develop. It's really about finding out what matters to people in your community and how you may be of service. So often a partnership develops not because you go out and ask somebody for something like, you know, free coffee from Whole Foods, but rather the development of a relationship which is about making the community a healthier and more sustainable place. Our experience is that when these types of partnerships with schools, with businesses, with religious institutions, with community centers, I mean, the panoply is huge, the potential is huge for partnerships. It can take up to a year to develop a sense of freedom and honesty and trust so that people feel free during the course of a project, once the partnership has been established, to talk about the things that are going wrong. So things like evaluation should be planned with the partners at the very beginning of a project and then checked in all the way through. How do you do the evaluation? Who is it for? Why are you doing it? What kind of methodologies do you use? And we're being asked more and more by people who support us with money to prove the ROI, the return on investment. So evaluation becomes a very important part of how partnerships are worked out. Whether the evaluation is, stories, that's qualitative, numbers, quantitative, arts-based evaluation, or mixed methods. So the establishment of a relationship is very, very important, and it's very important that if you're dealing in your work with people who are working at a high level, this is what we hear, that you make sure that that information filters down to the people who are operationalizing that work, who are actually in the trenches, so to speak, doing the work. So often we find that partnerships fall apart because there is an agreement, sometimes and often, in fact, MOUs, Memoranda of Understandings, where people actually put things in writing, they go through a long process, but then that information doesn't filter to the people who are actually delivering the programs. The notion of check-in is really, really important in partnerships. Is this working for you? But before that happens, before you get started, the notion of roles and responsibilities. Who is doing what? And do we have an adequate budget to do what we're saying? You know, do we have bus tickets available? Are we providing food? Is the location for the work adequate for the work to be done properly? All these questions, the formation of the budget, who monitors the budget, all of that has to be discussed, and there needs to be consensus around how these aspects are operationalized. I think that's all I want to say about partnerships. I'm really looking forward to chatting with you. I just want to talk for one second about training. Because you're a good dancer and you're an empathetic person and you have good observational skills and you're a good communicator does not make you a good facilitator. There are all kinds of skills that we need, both in terms of ethics, in terms of safety, and in terms of methodology that will help create the kinds of facilitators who are welcomed back into communities where they've already worked. And I'm a really firm believer in the need for people to take not one or two workshops on facilitating community arts. It is a really, really deep discipline. And there's lots to read about it, but the doing of it, the experiential knowledge. So I'm one of those people who really advocates for mentorship and internships. And that's how I learned, because there was nothing called community arts officially, although it's always been there when I started. I'm going to be 70 next year, and I've been doing this for 30 years. So I think mentorship, internships are really, really important. There are formal training programs. There are 2 to 3 week workshops that are not sort of drop in, drop out, but really have more comprehensive teaching and learning opportunities. We have a new master's in Art for Social Change at SFU, a 2-year program. Vancouver Moving Theater is bringing in Ruth Howard in a couple of months to do a 2-week workshop. David Diamond does workshops. There are things around. But one of the concerns nationally in our community of community engaged, community cultural development, whatever we call it, is that there are skills that are not being transferred. And there's a real concern amongst particularly the senior people who've been working. We found in our study, study, if you want to come have a look, there's an interim report which talks about all kinds of things, including the fact that about a third of the 200 or so organizations exclusively doing art for social change work in Canada are more than 20 years old. So that's kind of interesting. The other fact is that the field is growing exponentially right now across the country. So I think that's all I have to say. Thank you, and I'm right on time.
Thank you very much, Judith. That was great. Kind of bullet points to follow up on, for sure. Okay, our next speaker is Margaret Naylor. And Margaret is an artist, a perceptive and prescient thinker. And she's been a guide and a slave of the Arts and Health Project, which is a major partnership with the health sector.
Oh, wow. Thank you so much, Jill. I think I'm ready for my...
Oh, good.
So Marie asked me to come and give an outline for the Arts and Health Project for you to explain our model. I want to begin with an important acknowledgement that our project hosts programming for elders and seniors across the greater Vancouver area on the unceded territories of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh people, and we are truly grateful for the opportunity to do this work in this place. Our project is an ambitious one, and it is a rich network of, let me see if I can change that, it's a rich network of partnerships and collaborations that overlap the arts, recreation, and health sectors, the most important partnership being that between the Vancouver Park Board and the Vancouver Coastal Health. These two large agencies come together with the lion's share of the funding for the project, and to oversee the project with a shared commitment to serve our aging population, many of whom are increasingly vulnerable. Since 2006, the project has partnered with community and senior centers who contribute financial as well as in-kind support, including hosting our grant applications and assigning a dedicated seniors worker or programmer at each center who works with our professional artists or artist teams and the project coordinator to develop the project. Over the last 10 years, our project has nurtured 10 groups in 9 different centers, working together with a focus on a variety of different arts disciplines, including dance. We have targeted vulnerable seniors. We have targeted vulnerable seniors and marginalized communities with a focus on community engaged practice, which I won't go into because Marie and Cindy really covered that territory really well this morning. Ideally, over several years, the groups work for 9 months each year towards an exhibition and performance in June at the Roundhouse that brings the public in to witness the elders' collaborative work. We have here an example of our senior dancers from Carnegie Center performing at our showcase last year. Our Strathcona puppeteers doing a puppet performance, and our group of First Nations elders who workshop out of Britannia Community Center. Here they're dancing their vests to life, which they had created and designed themselves. But our work doesn't stop there. We have, from the beginning, had a focus and responsibility within our project to research and document the seniors' health outcomes. And here's the word outcome coming up again, which Marie talked about this morning. Connecting the cultural value of this work with the tremendous health and social value as a way of demonstrating that this programming can make people healthier, all with a vision of increasing the accessibility of this kind of programming for all older people. Our research partnership with the UBC School of Nursing in the first 3 years of the project resulted in our research report, which was released in 2012, and Dr. Allison Finney's published paper, which was published in 2014, and both those documents are available on artsandhealthproject.com on the resource page, if you're interested. We recognize that if we are trying to actually increase the accessibility of this program, that we need to actually have more professionals able to do this work. And our community of practice and professional development piece of our project is something that we are increasingly focused on. The community of practice is designed to provide opportunities for the staff team to share information and grow together, and our professional development workshops are designed to help new artists and new staff who are coming into the project to learn what it takes, from our point of view, to make this kind of a project work. With our new staff, we discuss things like what is the role of the artist in this project, because a lot of staff are not familiar with community engaged work and may not understand that this is actually a very specialized work and not know exactly what a community engaged artist actually would do. So we try and sort of do a general kind of discussion about what the practice actually entails. We also talk with them about what we expect that the site programmer or seniors worker will bring to the project as well. We talk about their support for the group with a real focus on outreach and the significance of that, particularly in the first year of project development, and working closely with the artist and the rest of the staff team is critical. I have a couple of examples today to show how the community outreach can be actually developed in very different ways. In the Downtown East Side, Second Mile Society has a population of several hundred seniors who visit the center regularly. And when I approached them and asked if they would like to join our seniors dance project at Carnegie, which is only two blocks down the street, they said they couldn't go. So we decided that we would go to them. So Julie LaBelle and I went down, and Julie led a workshop there with Emily, the seniors coordinator, and 40 women participated in that workshop. And they were very excited about this opportunity to work with Julie. And at the end, Emily said that the seniors didn't feel that they were able to go down to Carnegie Center, but that they wanted to participate in the project in some way. And she just suggested that they would attend our showcase in June as an audience that would represent the Downtown East Side and support the Carnegie dancers. So we were very excited by that possibility and tried to include them within the context of the project, functioning as an audience to support our Carnegie dancers that year. And Caroline has told me recently, who is now the coordinator of the project, taking over from me last year, that she's continuing to work with Second Mile Society and to develop the partnership with them. So we're very excited about that. In East Vancouver, Laura Forrester, who was the elders coordinator at the Aboriginal Friendship Center, arranged a chaperone service to escort First Nations elders who regularly go to the Aboriginal Friendship Center but never went to the Britannia Community Center, which again is only a few blocks away. Laura agreed to meet with them every week and escort them and stay with them at Britannia Center for an entire year until the seniors felt comfortable to go to the center on their own. In South Vancouver, Mohinder Sidhu worked with us for 3 years. She's a respected elder and educator in South Vancouver and worked with us to connect the South Asians community to the project at Moberly Arts and Cultural Center. Mohinder did a bunch of different outreach activities, but the one that was really successful for us were knitting workshops, which she organized and scheduled to take place an hour before our dance workshop would take place every week. And over the course of a year, there was crossover between the knitting activities and the dance, and eventually what happened is that the two groups melded together and began to dance and knit together, and it became a really exciting connection with these seniors starting to understand the connection with their previous activities and this new really exciting dance. So,
Thanks, Margaret. Yeah, artist, guide, and slave. Our next presenter is Julie Poskitt, who you might know from the BC Arts Council. But Julie is also a musician. Funnily enough, I thought she was a dancer. We met way back in 94, and I think it was because when I first met her, I think she was twirling with her daughter in the dance studio, and there were some tool and tutus involved.
Yes.
But she started as a musician. She's a thinker and a strategist, and she comes to us from the BC Arts Council.
Wow. Thank you, Jill. Hello, everyone. As I was listening to my colleagues speak here today, I thought that maybe what I should do is just dive right into the nuts and bolts of funding. I've been working at the BC Arts Council since 1995 with a six-year break in the middle where I went to work as a dance officer at the Canada Council for the Arts. Hello, William, wherever you are. And lovely colleague. And but as well as being a musician from the get-go, I grew up in a family that was full of art, and I think maybe one of my earliest community arts experiences was a neighborhood batik party organized by my mother, which produced very interesting garments. The BC Arts Council was constituted in 1995, and for many years, including this year and into the, I hope, not too long future, has really kept an artificial separation between what is professional art and what is community art. So the first thing I would like to tell you is that if you are interested in exploring a community arts project, either as a representative of an organization or as an individual, you'll have to talk to two people: the professional dance officer, myself, or the community arts officer, my colleague Monique. And we dialogue all the time, and you may have to explain your project all over to the other person. Maybe with some support, as I'll run over to Monique's office and say, I think I've got a community arts project coming to you. She might run over to my office and say, Julie, this is too professional for us. But that dialogue is very useful, I think. Because I'm the officer for professional arts, I have noticed over the years that there is a welcoming, an embrace of professionals whose practice is in community-engaged art. I listen to jurors and advisors speak all the time about this kind of gratitude that they feel for people who are bringing the art to the community. And also, I hear an appreciation for those who are bringing the community into the larger discourse about what is dance. So I would like to encourage you to, if you have a project, to speak to us about it, because there is, I'll say it again, an increasing desire to engage with artists who are able to speak with, for, by, alongside artists who don't even know they're artists yet, community members. So that's, I think, a really important thing. One of the things you should do when you have your conversation with any funding officer, and please, our funding programs at BC Arts Council are very different from those at the city and different from those at Canada Council, but one of the things you should ask is, who will adjudicate my request for funding? At BC Arts Council, we have mixed discipline juries and we have discipline-specific juries. If you come to professional dance, your jurors will all be dance artists, and they will come from different practices in dance. Some community engaged, many, I would say, well, many who are not so community engaged, although as careers evolve, people do tend to become community engaged at some point and be transformed by it. We also have programs that are adjudicated by artists from different disciplines. So, for example, if you put in a professional development request, which you should, to take advantage of those opportunities for professional development that Judith outlined, the people that will adjudicate your request, there might be a dance artist, there might be a community artist of some kind, there might be a visual artist, there might be a theater artist. You should know that. Why you should know it is this. is that you may have to explain in greater detail the kind of practice that you have for a mixed discipline jury than you would for a dance-specific jury, for example. Another thing that you should know about BC Arts Council funding is that it's almost never 100%. We do have some programs that are 100% funding, but for most of our programs, 50% is the maximum amount that you may request from BC Arts Council. What that means for you is that you need to approach your application with some support already in your pocket. It doesn't have to be cash support, it can be in-kind support. But this approach means that once the jurors are looking at your application, they can see that you've already engaged with the members of your community, you've already engaged with people who might support you with in-kind space or in fact, some other funding. So that those are some things to keep in mind. I would add that we don't have a lot of deadlines per year. We have one for professional dance, one for art space community development, a very specific program offered by my colleague Monique. And it's like that. In terms of mentorship, we have quite a lot of funding available right now through Creative Futures, which is a strategic investment of the province. For people who have just completed their training and are launching into professional careers, or for people who have, are under 30 and or launching into professional careers, having just completed their degrees, we have something called Early Career Development. And this is a wonderful program where we can support an intern or a mentee for further, a combination of further professional development and engagement, work, shadowing, mentoring, learning from professionals who are already practicing in the form or in the forms that you're interested in. So that's a good program to keep your eye on. We also have scholarship support for those who are going to attend a post-secondary institution and get a degree, a diploma, all the way up to PhDs. And I know that there are an increasing number of programs across the world that offer this kind of certification or recognition of studies in community engaged art. Happy to answer your questions. Happy to be here. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Julie. That was some really great and practical information. And William, yeah, from the County Council, I believe, is here today. There he is, William Lau. If you've got questions about County Council, we got them. We have one more presenter on our panel, so I'm going to introduce Joel Klein. Joel, as well as being an amazing artist, of course, is basically the Lord Mayor of dance for the very important organization Made in BC. Joel.
Thanks for that introduction, Jill. It's interesting to call Made in BC a very important organization. Made in BC is kind of important, I guess. It's kind of really big because it covers the whole province, but it's also really small because it's got a small budget. It does a lot because we work with a lot of partners, but we also intentionally try not to do anything ourselves, really. We're a capacity building organization and a network. So we were founded about 10 years ago by Robin Campbell, who was heavily engaged in community-engaged dance practice. And I really shouldn't take credit for any of our community-engaged programs. It's not my area of expertise. My job has been to listen to and to implement the suggestions of, first, Caroline Liffman, who worked closely with me. Next was Miriam Colvin, who's up in the room and works with us in Smithers and has been a great advisor, and Julie LaBelle, who works with us now. So I trust them, and they're fantastic. The original program of Made in BC, we were founded because there was a feeling that dance wasn't touring the province enough, professional, proscenium arch, dance. And we got involved in community engaged practice as an audience development tool. That was kind of early on in the thinking. We would provide some money to what we're now calling community engagement facilitators. I've forgotten the original term now. kind of dance champions in every community so that they could develop whatever they needed to develop for their community to become more interested in dance. As particularly when working up in Smithers with Miriam Colvin, who is an artist engaged in this practice, we started to see the benefit that community-engaged dance practice could have in community much wider, much deeper, and started supporting residency programming. So that was our next in. At this point, we're still doing the touring. We've got this whole other branch that does outdoor work with Francophone communities, and we now have a department of community-engaged activity. So under that, we've got still the Community Engaged Facilitator Program, those dance champions, some of whom are in this room. We've got an audience portal for kind of audience. I still tend to think in terms of audience, but a participant portal for potential community engaged dance participants to find projects. So this is a partnership with Parks Board. Parks Board partners with us on just about everything I'm about to mention. So it's a listing of every project that a community engaged dance participant could find in Vancouver, everyone who wants to be on the list and everyone that we were able to find and engage. So it's called Everybody Dance BC. It's available on our website. We've got a residencies program where we've asked for proposals, residency, community engaged residency proposals from artists, which are being juried on, it might be an annual basis, I think it's switched to an annual basis at this point. So there's a showcase of potential residencies that communities outside of Vancouver could access, proposed residency activities. They'd be like a week long or 2 weeks long. They have to be really intensive because we're bringing usually artists from Vancouver out to someplace 2,000 kilometers away. As part of our capacity building within the community of artists, we run peer-to-peer sessions. We've also got a dance shadow program, which is a little mini mentorship program. And we support conferences like this one. So this is a partnership amongst many organizations, including Parks Board and Made in BC Dance on Tour. I wanted to give a little case study of a particular project, because we're here to talk about, my understanding of this panel is that we're supposed to help everyone figure out what they could possibly do about capacity, whether they're someone who wants to make a project happen, whether they're a programmer who wants to make a project happen or an artist who wants to make a project happen. So typical of how we work, there's a project coming up at Trout Lake. I'm just gonna read the thing. This is gonna be the only time I read. An interdisciplinary project that combines dance, storytelling, live music, and sewing to explore consumption, materialism, identity, value, fast fashion, history, and memory, using clothing as the common thread. Common thread. Let's see what they did there. In this creative process, you will bring old clothes, make new ones, exchange stories, make and share dances. No experience necessary. So this is going to be taking place with the youth group at Trout Lake Community Center. Really, the genesis of this is that the artist came to Made in BC with this as a potential residency project. We saw opportunities for the artists to... Are you in the room, artists? Yes? No? This is Kelly McInnes and Rhianne Svelnis. Are you here? No. Good, I can say whatever I want. So we saw an opportunity for this project to be further developed and for some skill building for these artists. So we were looking for a way to help these artists test out this new project of theirs and to gain mentorship opportunities. We've had this long ongoing relationship with Parks Board, so we were able to ask Parks Board for help. They knew that Trout Lake had a really strong youth program with like 150 kids who show up every Friday and they make everything happen themselves, and it's like really well facilitated. Is that you? Oh, no, but great. So it was a safe place there's food available, there's space being made available by Trout Lake. So nevertheless, there are a bunch of costs that come up, and this is free of charge, right? So how do you do that? In the end, by the time, we're hoping that this project can be developed out and then brought out elsewhere in the province. So by the time we're done, we're looking at $60,000 to $75,000 spent on this project. We were lucky enough to get $35,000 through BCAC Youth Engagement. Yay, Julie and team. We're throwing in $15,000 from a multi-year commitment from Vancouver Foundation to help these kinds of projects through our organization, plus a bunch of our own in-kind, and you know, maybe some of us work hours that we're not paid for. That's also a thing that happens. There's probably $10,000-ish worth of in-kind from Parks Board. So that's how Trout Lake, without giving a dollar, that maybe there are some dollars, but that's how they're able to provide significant value. And then once we go into the province, each of the presenters, like theaters that we work with across the province, is going to have to put in some money and in-kind in order to make this project feasible. So that's going to amount to another $10,000. So that's how we make the magic $60,000 to $75,000 happen. That's this one project, and I'm sure we'll be able to discuss how many other projects occur.
Wow, thanks. That's exciting. I want to be young. I want to be part of that youth group. I want to remake clothes. Anyway, thank you very much, you guys. Of course, you're not off the hook at this point. What I do want to say is what I really heard from each of our panelists was you need to talk and talk and talk and talk. You need to look at creating joint and consistent understandings with your partner. So don't assume when you said one word or phrase that you both thought you meant the same thing. Keep talking, get those memorandums of understanding. Make sure that you're also talking to the people who are your partners on the ground. So you might have talked to the supervisor at the community center or the president of the association. Make sure you're talking to the youth worker. So then, you know, promises made in different places, you figure out what's practical, how it can work. So talk with your partners. Talk with your funders. Give them a call. Tell them as clearly and succinctly, don't worry about using, you know, the right current jargon. Tell them exactly what you want to do, and then listen carefully to what they're telling you. If they tell you something about your project that doesn't fit into their funding program, that's not the time to tell them that, yes, it does, because they probably know more about their funding program. Ask them why not. Ask them where it might fit and who they need to talk to. So talk with your funders. Let them know if your project changes after you got funding. Importance of knowing if you're doing a call and you don't have participants, figure out how you can talk to some of those people, or maybe the people who are at the organizations where those people are. If you're trying to, you know, bring in people from the Aboriginal Friendship Center and they're just not coming, go and talk and find out why not. And maybe, you know, you're from there, you can start working together on creative strategies. Talk. Get to know what people are doing so that in the neighborhood, different people and what their interests are and what their capacities are, so that, you know, when you've got your project, you can locate your partners and talk, figure out what it is that you might need as an artist or a community facilitator or programmer in order to do it, you know, in a really good, effective way. You know, we did hear that both formal education opportunities and supported mentorship opportunities are available right now. So thank you very much, you guys. Talk.
And listen, listen, listen.
And listen, 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 listen. Yes. Don't keep on talking when someone else is talking. Make sure you're listening. And absorbing. So now is going to be key to get into, you know, what we all want to talk about now and drawing you guys out. Working from the fact that we know that you guys have lots of questions. There's questions here. There's lots of experience there. There's lots of experience here. So that's going to be great. Do be succinct. I might even, you know, pop in and interrupt or redirect your questions. You know, it's so hard not to sink into your particular project and whether it fits into that funding program or something. So that's the key bits. There was two questions from the feedback boards that we had out there. So I'm going to kind of prime the pump by asking a couple of these questions. And you can think about what it was you exactly might want to ask. So the first one was, how do you define leadership in community-engaged dance? So what does leadership look like? And maybe if you've got an example. Go.
In the Arts and Health Project, leadership looks different in every group. There's a lot of reasons for that. In culturally, there's a lot of different expectations. So when you're working with different cultural groups, there's a different understanding about leadership across the spectrum. The capacity of the elders that you're working with also influence leadership, whether you've got really frail, a really frail group of elders who need a lot more support and guidance, then that would be much more of a traditional maybe relationship where the lead artist is making a lot more decisions than in a group where the elders are younger and more physically capable of doing and doing a lot of the activities that they can decide together. So it's really different. I don't think you can create have a one idea fits all at all.
I think one of the hardest things for a community arts facilitator to do is to both be attentive and responsive to reading the room, to understanding what's going on in the room. At the same time, to be thinking in the back brain about what would be good to deal with the reality that lives in the room. And this is a difficult leadership skill. It's not an easy thing to do off the bat. It needs to be practiced. And part of that practice involves learning about dialogic processes and about facilitation. One of the ways to deal, for example, with intercultural difference, and you know, we have all these problems with a colonial model where, you know, a white woman drops into another culture and doesn't know very much about it. And this kind of thing happens both locally and nationally, and particularly in North-South globally projects. But here's where partnership comes into play. Because if you have someone I call a cultural translator working with you, someone who knows the community really well, knows the culture, whether it's a teen culture or Vietnamese boat people culture, whatever it is, and who can act as a translator and someone who can explain what's actually happening in the room, even if you're all working in the same language, and I often work in different languages with a translator, it's very easy for people to misunderstand each other So I would say that leadership is about being sensitive and having the toolbox to deal with the many, many dimensions of what it is to be an arts-based facilitator.
Thank you.
Yes, so there's no easy answers here.
No.
I'm actually going to direct the next question first to our three panelists who work kind of institutionally around the projects. So Am and Julian and Noel. So it's about process versus product. How important is the final outcome for the kinds of organizations and programs that you guys have?
From my perspective, the process and the relationship building and the long-term nature of the relationship takes precedence over any type of income outcome. I would say income. We're actually working with two Italian theater artists right now. We've had a project funded through a foundation. One of the challenges: one of the practitioners is only an Italian speaker. They're here for a couple of weeks. Somebody was here for a visit 6 months ago. But the idea of trying to do an outcome in the 2 weeks was what was going to take the project potentially off the rails. It was once we just put that off of the table in terms of the outcome, the public side of a performance, then actually it took out all the tension in terms of what we're actually doing. The outcomes that have already happened is that the community groups that we're working with are already meeting with theater students from SFU. So without the artists even arriving here, those relationships are happening and will continue after the visit of them. And I think it goes across, but certainly our precedence is more around the longer term relationship building part.
Julie, next.
Both are very, very important. Process is not more important than product, but it's fair to say that if product is your desired outcome, you have to have a great process. At BC Arts Council, we often don't provide enough funding to go from the inception of the idea all the way to a finished production. And I find myself more and more advising people to break their project into two phases and bring one phase 1 year and the concluding phase the next year. There are different approaches for those. You have to think with a lot of rigor and clarity in the proposition of a research and development phase. It's also very difficult to find that matching support that you're going to be asking the BC Arts Council for. But it can be done, and the benefit of doing it that way is that at the end of your research and development phase, you'll have some beautiful documentation of the development. And that's very compelling material for the full production part. I hope that's helpful, because often people feel they only have this one shot. But in fact, a really great research and development phase can open up all kinds of possibilities for the further development, if everybody wants to do that, of a production. Sometimes, though, the process does end up being all that it needs to be.
I think it was Marie who was saying earlier that failure is part of success. And I think in most cases that's true. The number one thing that I end up thinking about when anything is being planned is it safe? And if the outcome is that unsafe things happened and people were hurt, that's not good. But in general, we're all about building capacity. So the question is, were things learned? Is more stuff happening afterwards? Ideally, yes. That would be important in the long term for us. But in terms of like having an artistically successful outcome of each project, I think that has to be defined for every project, what that is and how important it is based on the needs of everybody involved in that moment.
And it'll change. The product could be the process. I mean, in a storytelling, for example, storytelling project, the storytelling that people do is the product and it is the process. But often you find when things going to larger scale production that the original intentions of the producers, of the people doing the project, change over the course of the project itself when it goes to, as it goes into the production phases. So not to get stuck in a perspective about your work that is answerable to a funding proposal that you did, but rather to talk to the people involved and explain to them, you know, how things have changed and why they've changed and why you're going in the direction you're going. So, you know, you often don't know where you're going to end up in these projects.
I just want to say that in the Arts and Health project, we've noticed that the second year has got a lot more energy, like there's a lot more excitement and commitment within the group than in the first year, and we've really attributed that to the push to perform and present their work at the end of the first year, which we encourage every year that they do that. I think in our project we've always said that that process and product were both important, and I would continue to say that, but I would say that product's really a really important piece. Yeah.
Okay. So, the light's coming on you guys. Do you guys have some questions? I'm actually just going to say that when we talk about things like risk, and we talk about process and product, risk appears in different ways. And if you're working with a community that's expecting they're going to produce something and they're going to perform for the other people in their community, then the artist goes in with a risk, not knowing who's going to be involved, if they're going to come very often, how they're going to do that. But, you know, there's commitment there to your participants around what the product will be. So that, how does that get mixed into what you're doing? Mm-hmm. You guys, if somebody want to talk about a project that they've been involved in where they felt that the production was really important?
Actually, I wanted to bring in Luca on this question because not everybody was here at the keynote last night. And Luca had a very, he's a fabulous artist from, he's from Italy, but he lives in London. And he brought this example about youth and the product was super transformative. So Luca, give you the voice if you could say a bit. Repeat.
I think that you already said it. You know, it's not. Sometimes the process and the product are the same thing. You know, and I think last night what I mentioned that I believe that a thorough process can produce, only a thorough process can produce a good product, and vice versa. If you don't have a product to aim for, there is no process, or the process becomes a little bit lacking of something to achieve. So I think that they go hand in hand. And what can I say? Everything we do, and I do the projects I do in community settings, I'm always trying to strive for something, for excellence in terms of how much effort we put in, make sure that there is an outcome that can be enjoyed and experienced by other people. So it doesn't finish with the participant, but it sort of goes out and make people think again about the value of arts and participation. And also I was mentioning yesterday how important it is for the participants to be seen through the performance, through the outcome, in a different light, because that's what performance does. And so it becomes the whole project a transformative project for everyone taking part, participants and audience alike. I think it's not about money. I think it's not about resources. Of course, they're important, but I think it's about ambition and wanted to make the best. You know, I was talking to someone last night. Said, all we can do is to make sure we can take out the best of everyone we're working with. It's not because we are applying certain standards. You know, every project, every participant is different. But if we are allowed to take the best out of each one, whatever that is, that's we've done our job in a way. And push the art form forward. Even if it's a community dance project, you know, it's about pushing the art forward before everything else. Yeah. Sorry, I feel a bit out of space because of jet lag and my voice as well. You know. But I hope it made sense what I said.
Thank you so much for your keynote and your workshop yesterday. It was brilliant, and thank you for all of this. I'm in the process of doing a show with my daughter, and the product is that I would like to give you all you dance lovers, some free tickets. The show is called I Have My Own Steps, Mom. It's at the Fire Hall Arts Center at 4:15 on Sunday as part of the Fringe Festival. And it's very participatory. And because you're dance lovers and you have supported this wonderful project, if you just say Leading From Beside, the name of the conference at 4:15, you'll get a free ticket on Sunday, but you do have to pay the Fringe membership. But thanks very much.
So this is actually Olivia Davies, facilitator today in the workshop this afternoon. In response to the ideas around product, as a community engaged facilitator working with a number of different populations, my most recent experience working with participants who identified as women who had experienced living in the shelter system, for them, it was all about the process, and the product of though we had put it to the participants that there was the opportunity to have a community showcase or in studio in work in progress kind of showing at the end of it. At the end of a 6-week process, this was not a situation where the participants, A, wanted random public members to come and witness what they had developed. But I've also been in another experience where working with movers of different abilities who were really excited to share within their community what they had just done. So as a facilitator, again, I think it was mentioned at one point about reading the room and really being responsive and responsible to the communities that we're working with and exercising their right to say, no, I don't want to share, or yes, I would love to invite my best friend, my colleague, and my family to come see what I've just been working on. And in that intention of finding ways of yes, producing something that is of value to the participants. As a facilitator, we're really holding that space for them. We're holding this you know, I'm not going to go there, but this sacred space for them to really experience what it means to express themselves in new ways. And that doesn't always end up in a public setting performance or even a sharing in a public setting.
I do what I call vocal body work, and one of the first pieces that I did that I think of as being community engagement was called Earth Magic. It was held down at Jericho Park in 1999. And it involved, I think I had 8 professional performers. And then I also had a cohort of youth. I think I had 12-year-olds, 2 14-year-olds, a 16-year-old. And then I had a couple of people who were professionals, including the wonderful Paula Ross, who, it's so, like, I had every generation possible in the piece. It was so wonderful. And it was transformative for all of the participants, regardless of whether they were professional performers, because they'd never done a performance outdoors. They'd never done something that was sourced from the idea of community, and the idea of community, literally community building, because the original image for me for the piece was from the idea of how many, people built pyramids, how many people built the Easter heads, like what was that all about? And so this was, and it was also evoked completely from the natural surroundings of the piece. So that was one example where I think the product was important and the audience was completely participatory because they had to go with us and they had to actually participate in several of the activities that the performers participated in, such as singing around and drawing in the sand and a variety of things like that. So that was a pretty successful combination, I think, of those things. Another kind of thing that I do with my historical group is I do what's called a soiree. The population out there is invited to come in, and in a 2.5-hour period, we introduce them to one period or another of dances and music, and they get up and they participate, and it can be 3-year-olds to their great-grandparents. We've had that wide a range of people attending these things. And those are a very successful format as well. So professional musicians and dancers are participating with the public in that kind of environment. And then a third kind of thing that I participated in as a facilitator is with Voxy Music, which it's a community music experience, but what happens is we offer a wide variety of workshops to the participants. Whoever comes each week throws $5 in the pot and they experience the workshop, whoever is leading it, and we've had a lot of wonderful people as facilitators. The first 2 years that we did this, there were performances, but gradually it got to the point where the participants didn't care. It was just the being together, the creating the magic of the experience of being in the workshops. So they were enlivened, they were excited by the activity, but they didn't care whether they performed. So that's 3 different kinds of interplays with the notion of performance. And it seems to me any one of them is completely valid, completely empowering for everybody, and that it doesn't, that none of them need to be, you know, this is the way it's going to be, but there's all these opportunities.
Yes. Just really briefly, there are people who have sort of analyzed levels of community participation. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there's a huge diversity of how the audience or the participants act with each other. And so you have people like Suzanne Lacey, who is an American visual arts community engaged artist, is what she calls herself, but she comes into a community with a concept. And then through a process of dialogue and arts-based facilitation, they fill out that content. At the other spectrum, there are socially engaged artists who are doing their own work and who will invite the audience for some sort of response. So by putting up a comment, you know, tying it to a tree that's beside the artwork or is part of the artwork. So there's this huge diversity of practice about levels of engagement, and we have to be careful to kind of not paper the whole spectrum with one or two or three sets, because there are dozens and dozens of levels. Someone you might be interested to read is someone called Pablo Helguera, just one of the many writers about the field, who talks about five levels of engagement. He's done his own sort of analysis. But I'm just cautioning us not to make generalizations about what engagement means, because it means very, very different things for different people in different contexts.
We have a question at the back. Oh, sorry.
My name is Yvonne Chitra, and I have a Métis and contemporary dance company called Vini Dansi. And so I've had the great honor to do some community projects, artists and community projects. And just working with an elder, Maria Campbell, who's a writer and storyteller. So I was able to, she inspired the project to go to Batoche, which is the homeland of the Métis, where the Métis resistance happened, and to just reconnect with old stories and our traditional dances, and to bring back the traditional dances. Like what you saw today was the clickers and the square dance outfits. That's what the Métis dance has evolved to, but hundreds of years ago, was the long dresses, the cummerbunds, the leggings, and more gentler steps, and about 100 of them in a row. But the thing about it was that a lot of that has been lost, that tradition. So by going into the community and retelling these stories about the Métis Rougarou, which is like the werewolf, which comes from like Quebec, the loup-garou, and from France, the same thing there. So these stories, have evolved into the Métis culture, but like not very many people know about them. So, these stories have been lost. So this project, I was able to work with a group of youth and community. Like some of them were young and some of them were older, and we were able to teach them traditional forms of dance, contemporary of Métis dance, contemporary forms of Métis dance, storytelling, contemporary dance. I was able to work in the studio with teaching them contemporary dance and improv, and also the theater aspect of it with Maria, bringing, to tell that story. And so it was a wonderful project that some of the dancers were youth dancers and who had gone through a lot of trauma in their life. And somehow that some of that came out, their stories of their healing, like they were able to share this, like it was a really healing project too, like talking about the layers. But in the end, we had a platform, we had a venue of the National Batoche Historical Site. So it was about bringing life back to our homeland, bringing the stories that, people have lost those stories. So many Métis people don't know what's a Rougarou, so we worked with mask as well and brought that layer in. And then also, I was able to teach these young people like the traditional dances, contemporary and traditional style, and they're now have created a group, and that was one of the goals and the focus, to create a group. And they've already been asked like about five different performances in the community around Batoche and Saskatoon, and so like that's the product. It was great to have a platform also. A performance and a place to perform at the National Batoche Historical Site, because then international people from all over the world came there, and then we were able to share our dances, and I got those young people to start facilitating and start to teach us. I said, okay, it's your turn, you guys teach these people how to dance. So, the final product, was there was a lot of layers, and it was a really great, fantastic experience, and I'm grateful to all the funding bodies that made this happen. healing and joyful.
Just quickly, because I want to be very brief, there is a difference for us to do projects than to do programs. Like to do or run a project that like is going to go into community center or like a specific population and then you get funding for it versus the people that we want to run something that is sustainable and accessible for 40 years or 20 years and have continuity and then grow it and pass that knowledge. So for us that we're running programs, the Parks and Recreation Board has been terrific support and has allowed us also, specifically in our case, to evolve because the answers and the processes that we may have had at the beginning have changed. And that support that continues to be there and like seeing the evolution of the group and adapting to the needs and, oh, now you have more group here or more people and you need a different space and maybe a bit of funding for costumes and that evolution that has been, you know, that we've shared, I really value it, especially because we also come as professionals that in my case, you know, Christine and I, we both have other jobs. We both are doing like tons of other projects. We don't want to be pursuing every funding program that it's out there. We want, you know, the capacity to create and learn. So thank you to the Parks and Rec Board that have supported us in this journey. And yeah, that's it.
One more question. I think we've got someone in the back there. The lovely Caroline will race up another set of stairs.
Hello. More than a question, this is an invitation. I am here with a couple of hats. I'm a dance artist myself, and I am interested in presenting work in a way that engages the audience or the community in different other ways rather than the traditional settings of a performance, but I'm also a programmer and I work for the city of Burnaby. And I have to say that community engagement is at the heart of the programming in the recreation facilities. We do have other models and I would like to encourage exchange. And I also want to mention that in my opinion, the models are shaped by the artists that are challenging the conventional ways of presenting work and engaging. So I would like to invite the artists to send also your proposals to other municipalities. Each municipality works very differently, have different models, and have a lot to learn from each other. So I would like to invite anyone with projects to also reach out. And I am more than happy to facilitate and to take risks and research and create new opportunities. And thank you.
What a lovely note to end on, yeah. So I'm gonna say one tiny last thing. Yeah, you got a good idea, write it up and send it to a million places. Your time is precious and your ideas are important. And my rule of thumb is you should always have 3 grant applications out at any given time. So you get one back, good or bad, one goes out. Anyway, thank you very much to all the panelists, the complexity of how we make these things happen, the partnerships, the partners who are willing to figure out what role they play, Am, as you spoke about, the funders who really want to hear and want to help people understand where is the best place to go, people on the ground who are managing partnerships, like Margaret did with Vancouver Coastal Health and the Park Board, Judith's work in creating new opportunities for learning, and sharing information, and of course, Joel, for that broad complexity of things in the province. So thank you very much, and thank you, and we hope you're coming back tomorrow to come and dance.
Yes, indeed. Thank you so much, you guys.